Okay, class, so today we are going to learn about ancient Egypt. I'm pretty sure most of you guys have already learned about it, but we are just going to do a little review on what we've learned, okay? So our objective today is that students will be able to discuss the main features of Egyptian art and architecture. Okay, so I want everyone to close your eyes and imagine the question, okay? What is the first thing that comes to mind when you hear the word Egypt? Okay, open them up. Now, can I get 3 volunteers?
The god of animals, Anubis.
Okay. Adrian?
Just ancient. Like the geography of Egypt with like the desert, basically.
Bunch of dirt houses and pyramids.
Okay, anyone else? Good. Guys, I was thinking mummies, but that's a good way. I love those. Okay, so our first topic or subtopic for the ancient Egypt, sorry guys, is the Nile River. So ancient Egyptians settled along the Nile River around 5000 BC. The Nile provided necessities like water, food, and fertile land in a desert. In the months of June and July, the river would overflow its banks, leaving black silt on the ground, which made the soil great for growing crops. So my question to you as a class is, what other information do you know about the Nile River, besides the facts that I have provided? Does anyone know? Isaiah?
Instead of going from north to south, it goes south to north.
Yeah, that's right. I was looking for that answer. Thank you, Isaiah. Okay. Our next subtopic would be a pharaoh. So Egyptians believed it was rude to call their leader by his or her given name. Instead, they called him pharaoh, which means great house. So this is a little pop quiz for you guys. Who was the first pharaoh of Egypt? Was it Menes? Tutankhamun? Hatshepsut or Nefertiti Trinidad?
If I'm not wrong, I'm pretty sure it's Nefertiti.
Let's try again. William.
I think it's Hatshepsut.
I'll not
say it.
Let's try again. Let's see. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, Kimenes. So when a pharaoh died, he or her was given a place to spend eternity in a pyramid. Our next topic will be about pyramids. Okay guys, so pyramids were built by slaves or foreigners forced into labor, which was not cool. And 2.3 million blocks of stone, I spelled stone, so ignore that, estimating 2.5 tons each, were being cut and transported by the slaves. These pyramids were about 480 feet tall. And guys, I provided like a little visual for you guys to imagine how tall the pyramids were. There's a skyscraper, which was 30 stories tall. This is a wind turbine, which we use in a wind farm. There's the Statue of Liberty, and there's the football field. So you guys can only imagine how tall the pyramids were and how long it took them. So these pyramids were about 480 feet tall, like I just said, and it took about 20 years to build a pyramid, and it required $100,000 of men. So it's actually still a mystery as to how these pyramids were exactly built. What's crazy for me growing up, I always imagined people thinking aliens played a big part in the construction of the pyramids. I don't think it's that. It's probably just the 100 men that were part of it. Okay. Religion. Okay, here's another little pop quiz. What religion did ancient Egyptians practice? A, was it polytheism? B, Catholicism? C, Judaism? Or D, Confucianism? Joaquin?
I would have to say D, Confucianism.
Let's try again. Let's try one more try. Let's see. Yes, Austin. No, let's try again. One more try. Soleil.
Polytheism.
We're left with that one. But yeah, guys, it was polytheism. What this religion means is that the people of Egypt worshipped many gods, more than 700 gods and goddesses. So the most important god to the Egyptians was the sun god Ra, and Anubis or Osiris was the god of the dead. Thoth was the god of wisdom. Egyptians believed in an afterlife and that a person's behavior in this life would determine how he or she would spend eternity. That's really interesting to think about, on how we act now so that we don't suffer in the afterlife. So what that means is that the Hall of Judgment is how Egyptians also believed that the dead went into a Hall of Judgment, meaning that the deeds of their lives would be judged. Anubis or Osiris would place your heart on a scale that was balanced with a feather. The scale weighted your good and bad deeds on earth. If there's more good in your life, your spirit would have an eternity of happiness. And if there was too many bad deeds, Amut, the devourer of the dead, would destroy your spirit. I don't know, that's just a bunch of, I don't know, I guess you can say like, how would you call it?
Beliefs?
No, it could be like, what's that word I'm looking for? I'm trying to think. Yeah, Joaquin.
Kind of like the underworld in Greek mythology?
Yes, but what I'm thinking is like, I feel like the people, the Egyptians from back then thought of a lot of crazy stuff that, what is it, conspiracies?
Conspiracies,
yeah, that could happen, that could not happen, but it could be just a lot of hocus pocus, so, yeah. Okay, moving on to hieroglyphs. You guys do remember what hieroglyphs are, right? Because we worked on this. Yes, William, you have a question?
So, ever since, like, ancient times, a lot of humans have thought in religion that whatever you do in your current life affects how your afterlife is, because a lot of people still think that, like Christianity and Catholicism, and back then they thought that too.
It's crazy how that we think like history back then is going to be different from what we're doing now, but I feel like a lot of back then presented itself today, right? It's crazy. Anyways, so back to hieroglyphs. Hieroglyphs means sacred writing in Greek, which was the picture writing of ancient Egyptians. The picture writing was considered sacred because very few could understand it. I wouldn't be one of the ones to understand it because it was very difficult to read. And obviously people who could read and write hieroglyphs were called scribes. And then fun fact for the hieroglyphs is that, you know, you need to follow the direction of the picture. So for instance, if a vulture faces to the right, you would read the hieroglyphics from right to left. And then hieroglyphs could be written left to right, top to bottom, or right to left. There was no spaces or punctuation. So for example, like this eagle, I guess it's facing to the left, then we would start our reading the hieroglyphs to the left. I think same thing with this snake right here, same thing with this hand, but I don't see any of them facing right. But yeah, it was really interesting to read that. I don't think I would be able to be honest.
Maybe the cake.
Or maybe the cake? Because
the sea actually did notice in a different, in simple hieroglyph alphabets. I saw some were pulling of the seas were pointing to the left and some were pointing to the right.
Yeah, see? There's a difference. So that's why I would not be able to read hieroglyphics. Anyways, papyrus, guys, something you guys did, which is really cool for, I guess, our STEM day. And just a little review for you guys. Ancient Egyptians found reed growing along the Nile River that provided many necessities, which was the aquatic plant. I don't know if you guys knew what papyrus was. Did you guys know it was a plant?
Yeah.
Did you guys know it was a plant? Okay, well, this aquatic plant, papyrus, would grow to be 15 feet tall. So this is where I provided like an image for you guys to think about, like, look how tall this plant would grow. And with that, you know, the Egyptians would wove it into mats, rope, baskets, and sandals. So the root of the papyrus was also a source of medicine, food, and perfume. So I guess the root of it, they would use it for, like I said, medicine, food, and perfume. And like I guess the middle part and even the top of it, they would use it for robe, baskets, and sandals. Now the strips of papyrus were also laid, you know, side by side vertically, and another layer of cut papyrus was also laid across the first layer horizontally, which is what we did for STEM Day. And this is another little closer picture of what a papyrus looks like today. It was interesting to see when I was doing the research on papyrus, guys, was that the papyrus plant was extinct for like so long. And I think it was back in 1960s when someone created a plantation of the papyrus, which was really interesting to read about.
It still exists now.
Yeah, so it exists now because of that one plantation that they created back in, I think it was in Egypt. Somewhere on that side of the world. Okay, mummies. Okay, so Egyptians believed Ka. Does anyone know who Ka is? Isaiah?
The sun god and the main god that they worship.
Needed a body to call home, so they developed a mummification process. So this mummification began around 26,000 BC and used this process for 3,000 years more. And then here's a fun fact, guys. The procedure took about 70 days, which is 2 months and a half, and involved drying out the entire body. The embalmer, which was the person that was wrapping the body, who performed the task, kept his identity a secret by wearing the mask of a jackal, so he looked like Anubis, the god of the dead. This was interesting to read too, guys, because I feel like the embalmer would mask itself so that, let's say, the person that died wakes up. They're able to, I guess, fall back to the dead or something. I don't know. That's what I think, that they would cover their identity. So the embalmer would then remove all the organs from the body to prevent decaying, which also involved the brain. This was actually interesting to read. The brain was removed through the nose using a long metal hook.
What?
Yeah. It was, I don't know, they didn't have the tools to open up, you know, the skull and all, so that's why they had to come up with these cool long metal hooks. Yes, Ethan, you have a question?
Ka is actually the
See, I had that same thought process, but I don't think it was like that, because it's just going to come in pieces.
Yeah, because
the brain, think about brain as like,
because I was like imagining it, and all I was thinking was like, they would like get one piece and it would just come out like it was a noodle.
Well, think about brain as like grinded meat. That's how I imagine it being. So that's why they would just put the hook and just keep pulling out brain pieces.
And another thing that made me like just go like,
I don't know. That's something that we gotta ask these embalmers people, but we don't have any. Yes, William, we have a question.
So, Ra is the sun god, and the Egyptians thought there was a spiritual body and like a physical body, and the spiritual one was Ka?
Yes.
No.
Okay, moving on. Also, guys, it wasn't just humans that were being mummified. There was also animals such as cats, birds, bulls, monkeys, and crocodiles that were also mummified. And here's a little fun fact. The first mummified lion was unearthed in 2004 from a tomb of Saqqara. It dates back about 3,500 years. This video that I'm about to show you guys, it's not the lion that was unearthed, but there was these archaeologists that found interesting mummified animals in a cave. See if I can do it. Oh,
يعتبر العنصر الشعبي الوحيد اللي فيه معنى. بس دايما انا احب الحاجة الصعبة مش السهلة. يا نهار أبيض لف وقلب راح تعمل لنا تبص مرسوم البق والعين والخير والودان ماستر بيس بالقريب كده يعني احنا هنا بلاد. كان عندنا وقت بالمنظر دي. انت لو عندك قطة زي دي هتعمل بيها ايه؟ انا خفت العيال خفت العيال
Okay. not confused. He, a big baby, and it's got an arch in the back of his river. So if it were stretched out properly, it would be more than a meter like this from head to the base of its tail. Now, this is no domestic cat. It's too big for a lynx. It's a leopard or a cheetah. So maybe the design is different because this is a different species.
Yeah,
look at this. Okay, let's just see this. Just an idea. Okay, wrong. Okay. Huh? See? Because remember the way the lion's round? Maybe this is supposed to be more like that. And they put the wings on because, of course, they're used to having the horn on this one. Based on the markings that are painted on the face, that this is actually maybe a baby lion. It's a lion cub. This is just extraordinary because there are stories of lion hatchlings, and some of us have been looking for years and years and years for this. But now the logical place is the Bubasteon. I mean, it's mind-blowing to think of what this lion might represent in terms of our understanding of ancient Egyptian culture, economy, religion. It also changes how we think about how the ancient Egyptians were interacting with wild animals, how they might have been feeding them or keeping them tame, how they might have used them to worship, but also in the same way as with some of the other animals, they were feeding them and they were then giving them as offerings. It's just sick.
Okay guys, what do we think? That was cool, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, moving on. It's actually a little documentary that could be on Netflix. That was just a little clip, I think, that I got.
If I'm not wrong, I think it says something about the secret of this Harakon or something.
Yeah, it's on Netflix, so if you guys have Netflix, you guys can always see what's up with the movie. But that was a little clip. Now that we finished the video and we finished our little presentation, here are some questions for you to think about so we can create a little discussion. Should mummies be on display in museums? If I can get a vote with raising your hand by saying yes, they should be displayed on museums, or no, they should not be displayed on museums. But this is what I want you guys to think about. What if someone finds your grave a long time in the future and decides to put you on display in a museum? Do you think you would like people staring at what's left of you? Or would you not care at all? So what do we think? Should museums be on display, yes or no? Yes. What about no's? Wow. Can I get a person to explain why they would like? Who raised their hand to say yes? Who said yes as to why mummies should be displayed in museums? Who raised their hand to say yes? Elaine, why do you think?
It was pretty fascinating to see it on the video. Like, it'd be even more interesting to see it in person.
Right. Okay. What about to the people who said no, why they should not be displayed in a museum? Aiden. Personally, why don't you think museums should be in display?
I would not want my body to be displayed.
You wouldn't want to be worshipped? Like, what if they're worshipping
them? Well, I mean, they're going to find, like, let's say 50 years from now, they're going to see, not even 50, but let's say 200 years from now, they're going to see a body of, like, this is an imagination, guys, a sixth grader. They're just going to see, like, oh, you know, he was 5 foot, had braces, they're just gonna witness what you are. I don't think they're gonna display you with your, like, face. I mean, they're just gonna cover you.
We're not gods. We're not worshipped cats.
Yeah, no, they wouldn't. Joaquin, you have a question?
Actually, it's more so of a comment. I think some people might think, this student died of too much homework.
Maybe. Too much stress, anxiety going on.
Yes,
Trinidad.
I have another theme for, like, why I don't think mummies should be on display.
Why don't you think?
I think they shouldn't, because then, like, you realize that, like, sometimes you don't know, like, what if they're, like, because, you know, you, because in ancient Egyptian, like, in the culture, we don't, like, we never really established the fact, like, because when you die, you practically still be connected to your body, even if you're in the afterlife.
No,
how? Because when you die, you'd have the same body that you would in the afterlife.
Right. Well, guys, if you think about it, we weren't meant to dig up mummies. It's kind of disrespectful, in my opinion, because mummies were meant to be buried or were meant to be in pyramids so that they would, you know, rest in peace and, you know, remain happy in the afterlife.
And another thing is that, like, in ancient Egyptian culture, it is said that when they're put in the pyramids, they're meant to stay there for the rest of eternity.
Right. So what we're doing, I don't think, is, like, even the cats, I don't think they were meant to be.
Yeah, because then again, like, I feel like when you take, like, a mummified being out of wherever you found it, it's kind of ruining their peace, because, like, you're messing around with their body. You're, like, opening their casket and, like, bringing them back into our world.
It's kind of hard.
I feel like that is disrespectful to their culture, because, when you try to, like we've turned this in, you are trying to mess with a culture that we don't even fully know yet.
Mm-hmm. Who cares? They're not going to see the
there, you, and there is a lot of spiritual things that have happened that are with the Egyptians, and you never know what can happen.
And then another thing.
Okay, let's let Julia answer this first question, and then we're going to move on.
I think it's already just people here already, like, getting around your grave, and then if you look on the side, you can see.
Yeah, I know. I agree, guys. I agree with you all. Okay, now, well, that's moving on to our next question. Do you think exhibiting museums is disrespectful, or do you think it adds our knowledge of ancient Egypt? It is a form of disrespect, in my opinion, and I agree with all of you who think it is disrespectful. And I also think that it does add knowledge to our knowledge of ancient Egypt. So it's a 50-50.
Yeah, I was about to say that. If we didn't know, there would be no history if we didn't know.
Yep. Yeah, I agree. William, we'll go with William, and that's it. We're going to move on, okay?
It's because Joshua was just saying, like, because then we wouldn't know as much about it.
Yep.
And it's true, because ancient history, I'm pretty sure, was not documented. Actually, I know it wasn't documented, because it's ancient. They don't care. If... Yeah. So, that's how people know about, like, more modern history, like, because it was documented.
Right.
But history back then wasn't, so, like, all
well,
we can
do... It was kind of documented, just because they would write information on their papyrus.
Yeah, there were people who... Yeah, but it wasn't, like, documented events.
Documented events.
Not as much.
I agree with you, William. Well, guys, moving on to our little activity, we are going, it's five questions. I'm pretty sure you guys will be able to answer them really quickly. And then there's going to be a little, critical thinking questions at the end. And it's basically a little discussion that we can talk about once we're done with it. And after you guys are done with actually answering the questions, there is a little second question to your first question that says, cite your evidence, and then it provided a sentence frame where it says, according to, and this is where you go to a website, or you guys can even write my name. So according to Ms. Madrigal, this is where I got the information from.
How do you spell your name?
Madrigal?
I know MS.
MS. Mad? Like you're mad? R I
G A L.
G A L. And as soon as we're done with our worksheet, we can go ahead and discuss the last two questions, okay? So we can have a whole group discussion.
Okay.